Right, next up. What on earth is going on here, Gary?
Oh my goodness, what is that?
We were trying to work out what was going on. Gary Porter, welcome back to Vicarage Road. What's it like to be back?
Always great to come back. Great memories from many years ago, so always fantastic to come back.
Changed a bit the old place?
Yeah, it's pretty impressive now, isn't it? The Pottsos have done a great job.
When was the last time you were back?
Actually, I think I've been this season. Earlier on in the season, I occasionally come back, but I tend to sort of just come back and, you know, pick up the game and just as a fan. So it's good.
We just had a chat beforehand. We like to do something a bit special with the old players, but given you given you played 472 times for this great club, we thought we'd go the extra mile and do a real trip down memory lane. So we've got a bit of fun for you, Gary. So
okay,
away we go.
No worries, fire away.
Right, picture number one. I want you to tell me what's the first thing that comes into your head and tell me a bit about that period. Okay?
I'll try.
Picture
I'll
one.
Do me best. Wow. That's 1982, I think. Probably the first picture.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I remember that. I remember the sponsors, Iveco, on the shirt there. So that would have been 1982, my first season at the football club and Watford's first season in the top flight.
What was it like to come down from Sunderland?
Incredible. You know, I came down in obviously the years earlier than that, when the club were in Division 3 and saw it rise, you know, from Division 3 all the way through. And it was incredible because that year, my first season, was Watford's first ever season in the top flight. So, and I don't know if you're going to lead onto it, but the first game here that season was against the opponents today.
Everton.
Against Everton, yeah.
Wow. We'll talk about your first, your proper debut. Was it Wolves away, was that right?
Yeah, first time I ever got on the pitch with the first team was Wolves away, which was great. We were in a very commanding position. I can't remember whether we were 4-0 up or 5-0 up, but we were leading well. And I managed to, Graham put me on for the last 20 minutes, which was fabulous, you know.
Mo Johnston scored two that day. I bet that was a bit of a lively night out if he scored a couple.
Yeah, we can't remember the night like after. That's a problem. It was a great striker, great finisher. And, he was fantastic that day. As I say, the lads getting to a 4-0 lead or whatever it was allowed me then to get my debut and minutes on the pitch, which was fantastic.
Well, we'll go to picture number two and see if the haircut's getting any better.
Okay, the great man himself,
Mr. Tom Waller. You've just seen him in there?
Yeah, I've just had a couple of photographs taken with him actually in there. He was the reason, I think probably the main reason for me having the career I did. So when I first ever came down as an 12-year-old on trial, Tom was the youth team coach then, and obviously, you know, his record over the years, bringing young players through to the first team, is second to none, fantastic.
Just how hard a taskmaster was he?
Yeah, he was tough. It was tough in them days, yeah. I mean, we...
Running around Castleby Park?
Running around the park, running around here, running up and down the terraces here, you know, it was a continuous thing. Look, what it was, the fitter you were, the better chance you gave yourself, and that's what it was. And we were a fit team, we were a fit group of players right through, not just the first team, but the reserves, the youth team, and they were all, you know, drilled by Tom, and it was tough.
Great to see him just now?
It is, yeah. I see him every time I come down, so lovely to see him. Caught up last year on his birthday. I took a cake round for him for his birthday, which was nice. So yeah, it's always great to see him. Yeah.
Next picture.
You're
going to be able to tell me when that was.
That looks like the FA Cup quarter-final at Highbury, I think.
Correct. What a day that was, huh?
Steve Sims in the background there. Yeah, so, fantastic day. 3-1. I think we beat Arsenal that day.
One of the best times in a Watford shirt that day? Because that was a decent Arsenal team, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a very good Arsenal team. Yeah, really good Arsenal team. And, we went there and turned them over. And there was a little bit of controversy at times in the game. But, it was fabulous.
I'm showing my age here. I remember that game. Did David Bardsley play as well as I remember?
He did, yeah. I think he was playing against Kenny Sansom that day. Kenny eventually came back to Watford as assistant manager at one point. And Kenny was the England fullback. And, yeah, Dave absolutely roasted him, yeah. Yeah, he was unbelievable, Dave Bardsley.
Right, next trip down memory lane. The big man. gaffer. Great man.
Yep, boss. Yep.
Just how big an influence on your career was this man?
Massive on everybody's career. You know, the way he had the club set up, the way he ruled the club. There's not enough words to say about him. He was an incredible man. You know, incredible man.
Did you almost go to Villa with him when he left?
He wanted me, yeah, he did. He came in for me, and I remember having a conversation with Dave Bassett, who was a manager at Watford at the time. And I think Bassett wanted Mark Walters at the time, who was at Villa. And I think Mark didn't want to come to Watford. He ended up going to Glasgow Rangers, but Graham came in for me. And Bassett just said, I don't want you to go, you're not going. And that was it. That was the end of it. So,
do you remember where you were when the news filtered through? It sadly passed away?
No, I think it was in bed. I was actually lying in bed, yeah. And the news flashed up on the TV. And myself and Karen, and I was just complete shock, you know, real shock.
This legacy lives on in this place, doesn't it?
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's, you know, what he built along with Elton, obviously, is still here. And, you know, you've got the stands, the Elton John stand and the Graham Taylor stand, which is very fitting, you know, for what they did for this football club.
All right, next up, what on earth is going on here, Gary?
Goodness, what is that?
We were trying to work out what was going on.
Yeah, I don't know. I've no idea. That's obviously Gibbsy, me and Gibbsy. I don't know why Gibbsy got the best deal there, because he's got the Watford kit on, and for some reason I've got this stripy top on and a false tash.
You drew the short straw.
I did, definitely drew the short straw. I don't know. Anything to do with Corinthian casuals, maybe?
We're not sure. We're happy you could shed some light on it.
Yeah, I don't know. No idea.
Just on Nigel, how close were you with him?
Yeah, fantastic. We came through all the way through together. When I first came down as an 11-year-old, Nigel was obviously already in the club, in a football club, and we became friends from then, and we're still friends now. And obviously delighted that he's gone on in his career and continued in football, and I believe he's at Spurs now, isn't he? So great guy, fantastic guy.
Remarkable to think in the history of this great club only Nigel and Luther made more appearances for this club than you have.
Yeah, it is. When I look back at it, I mean, you know, Luther obviously incredible legend, and you know, the highest obviously appearance maker, and as I say, then me and Gibbs are who came through all the way through together. You know, I mean, Gibbsy probably would have had a lot more games if he hadn't had the knee injury.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I had a couple of injuries, a broken ankle and a broken leg at some point, but I think Gibbsy might have surpassed Luther if he hadn't had them injuries, you know.
Here we go.
Wow.
I was there that day.
Semi-final?
Yeah.
Villa Park.
Mixed emotions, because semi-final in FA Cup, but not the result everyone wanted.
No, and it was a bit of, when you look back, obviously what happened with our goalkeepers. Tony was definitely out, Tony Courton. Steve was nearly fit.
Tony Courton, it's adamant to this day Steve could have played.
Steve could have played. Steve was ready to play, and the decision was made on Saturday morning of the game that Gary was going to play, Gary Plummer. And so Gary played, and we lost him. We could have still lost the game. We don't know what would have happened, but certainly Steve was fit. He put himself forward to play that game, yeah.
Just a good Spurs team.
Outstanding, yeah. I mean, Clive Allen, how many goals did he get that season? 49 goals.
49 goals.
You know, I mean, that's me with Paul Allen. And I remember Chris Waddle in the team, Glenn Hoddle, Ozzy Ardiles. And we had a game plan that particular day. We'd worked on it during the week. And I think after about 25 minutes, the game plan was out the window.
Rip it up and start again.
Yes, Steve. And I think the second half was a lot better for us. I think did we win the second half, or did we draw the second half? It might have been 1-1
the
second
1-1,
half.
Yeah.
So, just all went wrong. Unfortunate. You know, and so close to another trip to Wembley, and for me, it would have been the first.
Yeah. You know? See what we got next. Can't talk to you without talking about this game, huh?
Right, okay, that's me lining up to take a penalty. I presume that's the Bolton game.
Correct.
So that's the winning goal against Bolton that day.
What a day that was.
Yeah, no, unbelievable. My only hat-trick in top-flight football. And, the penalty to win the game.
What were the nerves like? And were you always taking it?
Yeah, I didn't suffer nerves, believe it or not, when it came to penalties. I sort of had an idea what I was going to do with it. I think over the years, I didn't miss many, probably three maybe over the years. And yeah, I felt confident to take it. And I was the penalty taker anyway, so yeah, I would have took it.
Your best moment here, that game?
Oh yeah, incredible. I mean, to be 3-0 down.
Was it 78?
20 minutes to go. 3-0 down, 20 minutes to go. Most of the fans had gone.
I thought about it.
You know, we were getting the whistles and the boos, so we were getting a lot of stick. And yeah, just strange, scored the first one. I scored the second. And I think that was it then. When I got the second one, the belief that we could do something. And he brought Ken Charnley on, and Ken got the third. And yeah, I think I took the corner actually, what won us the penalty.
That's right.
Whether it was a penalty or not, I don't know. If you look at it now, but yeah, we were fortunate, and yeah, that turning point was the second goal for sure. The belief that we could actually at least get a point out of it, you know. But to get 3 points was incredible.
I've dropped one here, and he won't thank me for dropping this one. How could I drop this, man?
Yeah, incredible. Yeah.
Sir Elton John.
That was the FA Cup final. Funnily enough, against Everton again.
What was your memories of him? Any good Elton stories?
No, just an incredible chairman. You know, I mean, obviously he was a superstar. So he would always come in across the changing rooms before the game, wish the lads all the best. He would always come to the changing rooms afterwards, primarily, hopefully, to congratulate us. But yeah, so just, you know, for a young lad like me coming from Sunderland, and like, you know, you're standing close to Elton John, and he's a superstar, world superstar. You know, it's amazing, absolutely amazing.
Stories of his parties at his house, infamous?
Yeah, not infamous. Nice days out. Garden party every year before the season started. That was for all the staff. It was an incredible club because it was a family club. And you know, you look back and everybody was there. Les Simmons, the groundsman. Hazel, the cleaner. Pat Malloy, the old physio. So all the office staff. I mean, in them days, there wasn't the kind of staff that there are now.
Of course.
There's a lot more staff now. But it was a unique club. It was such a family club. And, you know, that just epitomised it, really. I mean, before the season started, we're at Elton's house having a garden party, sitting in his gardens and drinking champagne and, you know, just enjoying the day and enjoying the occasion, you know?
Great times. A couple more to go, Gary.
Yep, no problem. Okay, so that's, I can't remember the year, which player of the year?
1993.
93, yeah, so, yeah. That's it, me and Ian Bolton.
Proud day?
Yeah, very proud day, yeah. Yeah, very proud. I mean, to get club player of the year, special, very special. So probably the greatest achievement for me,
really,
with the club, is winning that award, yeah, without a doubt.
Any mementos of that? Do you get a replica? Have you got a photo of that day anywhere around?
Photographs that you know, end up in a cupboard, really, or in a box in the loft. But fantastic. I think, did I get goal of the season that season as well?
Yeah,
so I'm
cleaned up.
I got two awards.
You needed a new trophy cabinet after that
really
season.
Good, yeah. I don't know whether I deserved the player of the year, but I got it. I'm sure there was plenty of people who would have deserved it as well at the time.
Yeah. And one along a similar line, just to finish.
Yep. Okay, so again, not that long ago, actually.
2015.
Only a few years ago, yes, to enrolled in the
Hall of Fame.
With, funny enough, Big Tony Corton, and Graham there as well. It was a great evening. Actually, that and the Player of the Year award was probably the two biggest achievements for me here. And it was a special night, obviously, see Graham again. I see Big TC because he's still in football. In fact, funnily enough, TC's chief scout of Sunderland now, my hometown team. So we come across each other quite a bit.
Well, thanks for that, Gary. Enjoy the trip down memory lane. It's a pleasure to have you back, and you're welcome back anytime.
It's a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Hey, click here for more video. Hey, click. Come on. Click. Come on, bro.